So OpenAI is fixing their reputation, and after the whole thing with DeepSeek, they just released two open-weight reasoning models, GPT-OSS 20B and 120B. And it's a big deal because it's their first open LLM release since GPT-2. The models come in very reasonable sizes, targeting both researchers and everyday users. And OpenAI collaborated with Hugging Face, Nvidia, AMD, Llama, LM Studio, and many others to deliver OSS. Let's start with the model overview. GPT-OSS comes in two flavors, 120B and 20 billion parameter models. Both are reasoning models, which means they first generate some reasoning output before spitting out the final answer. And this reasoning text is finally not hidden from us. It cannot be hidden, because you now own the weights and run the model. There is no one in the middle who can hide it from you. This is great. Both models natively support 131,000 token context windows, and they use the mixture of experts architecture, or MO. They use 128 experts for the larger model and 32 experts for the smaller model, with 4 active experts each. Now, I really like that they use MO even for the smaller model. 20B is already a great size on its own. It means you can run it locally even on your laptop, and MO will make it much faster, which is great for reasoning models. So the 20B model should really act as a 3.6 billion model when it comes to inference. The large model should be more like a 5 billion model. You still have to load all these parameters into your memory though, and that takes us to the next point, quantization. OpenAI did something interesting that honestly might be the best thing about this release. Traditionally, models are often trained with a 32-bit or 16-bit precision. I usually use 16 bits for training my models, but that can be slow and we end up with large models. Alternatively, we can train in lower precisions because of the recent development in GPUs, which now support 8-bit, 6-bit or even 4-bit precisions. The problem is that such low precision is hard to work with. They cause instabilities during training and well, you also need these expensive GPUs that support it. Earlier this year, DeepSeek showed us their mixed precision framework, which uses FP8, 8-bit precision, and then Meta managed to train their Llama 4 models with FP8 as well. And now OpenAI has managed to train their models with MXFP4, which uses 4.25 bits, and I think that's quite impressive. Again, without a careful setup, such low dynamic range increases the risk of degradation, underflow and overflow errors, and I've only seen a very few papers recently like this one that propose successful methods for such constrained training setups. But yeah, if you can do it, you will train your models much faster, and MXFP4 also means that you need only about 16 GB of memory to run the smaller 20B model. But again, you need to run it on something that supports MXFP4, like Hopper or Blackwell GPUs. If you cannot use those, the model will run in 16 bits, and you will need about 48 GB of memory for the smaller 20B model. However, OpenAI collaborated with Llama and LM Studio, and they both now have kernels that support the MXFP4 format natively, without additional quantizations or conversions. That means you can still run them on your laptop in Llama, but you won't be able to fine-tune them in PyTorch, for example. Alright, let's look at the benchmarks now. OpenAI has published a nice suite of benchmarks for both models, covering a wide range of reasoning tasks, showing strong results overall. This is all nice, but look, as I've mentioned many times before, we can't just look at these absolute numbers and compare them with other models like Gwen or Llama. I've said this in previous videos as well, we don't know OpenAI's preprocessing scripts or evaluations, and it's generally better to wait for independent third-party evaluations. But still, I think this table tells us something interesting about the reasoning power of the models. You can see that OpenAI mentions three types of reasoning here, low, medium, and high. That's because GPT-OSS has a unique prompt feature. You can specify which reasoning mode you want to use, with medium being the default, and the model is trained to respect it using either fewer or more reasoning tokens accordingly. And we can see that in almost all cases, asking for more reasoning delivers much better results. For example, in coding tasks like Sweepbench, the difference is about 15 points. And here is another set of charts showing AMI and GPQA. AMI is a math exam benchmark and GPQA is a multiple choice scientific knowledge benchmark. You can see that as we increase the reasoning level, GPT-OSS generates more tokens and accuracy improves as well. OpenAI claims that the larger OSS model is close in performance to O4 Mini, but I'm not sure. I tried it and while it seemed okay and kind of passed the vibe test, I found O4 Mini better. And I also got better results with Gwen models. If you've tried it, let me know in the comments below what you think. I'm very curious whether people liked it or not. But yeah, I still think we should wait for more independent results. Now, let me get one thing straight about this being an open source release. This is quite important, and it's one of the reasons I started this channel, because there are lots of people out there, people who probably never trained a language model in their life, feeding us with misleading information about AI. I've already seen many articles and also other YouTubers talking about this being a fully open source release, but is it really? Let's first start with what is open here. OpenAI released the model weights, which means you can download the model and use it locally for anything you want. Great. It's also released under the Apache 2 license, which is a permissive license that allows you to freely use, modify, and distribute software, even in commercial projects, as long as you include the license text and provide attribution notes. Awesome. However, open source essentially means full transparency and reproducibility. So can I train my own GPT-OSS? No, we don't have the training code and the original datasets. Can we learn from this release and innovate as researchers? It's not easy because we lack lots of architectural details. There is no research paper behind these models, just a model card. And for example, everything about the architecture is mentioned in these three paragraphs. Or everything about their quantization setup is described in this one short paragraph. In comparison, DeepSeek did much better because they shared a full paper with lots of training details and insights. But they also didn't share their training data. A great example of a truly open source project is Pythia. They shared the detailed documentation of their dataset, the full training code and inference pipelines, and checkpoints for all trained models. So you can see there are many levels to open source. This is a highly discussed topic. For example, Percy Liang, a Stanford professor, talked about this in last year's EMNLP conference, talking about how access shapes research. And that nowadays, most research lives within the confines of APIs and fixed weights. By the way, the Open Source Initiative, who first established the term open source in 1998, recently released their first open source definition for AI, where you can find more details about everything I just talked about, like data information, code, and parameters. But given all I just said, I need to give kudos to OpenAI for actually presenting their models correctly, because they either use the term open models or open weight, and both are correct. The problem is more with the people not understanding the differences and presenting this as a fully open source release. Anyways, that's all for today. Please consider subscribing if you liked the video, and thank you for watching.